Try to compute the following limit yourself first, and then use this video to see whether your answer is correct and whether you have all the essential steps. And now we compute the limit real part of z, imaginary part of z, divided by 2z, and we take z to 0. So, what do we do? As usual, we set z equals x plus iy, so the real part of zx and the imaginary part of zy, and substitute it over here. And there we have our f of x and y, and we will set x and y to 0, 0. So, you know, in a limit like this, the limit should be independent of the path. So, if you go along the x-axis, you get some limit. And if you go along the y-axis and send y to 0, you get some limit. Or if you go along some other curve, you all get a limit. And this answer should be independent of the path you take. If the answer depends on the path, then your limit does not exist. And if your answer is the same for all possible paths, then your limit exists and is equal to that value. So, what we usually do, we first go along the x-axis and the y-axis and see what happens. So we set x to 0 and we take y to 0, so along the y-axis. So substitute x equals 0 in your function, you get 0 times y divided by something non-zero equals 0. And if you then take x to 0, y to 0, you just get limit of 0. Taking y to 0 remains 0. And going along the x-axis, and then we set y to 0, and we take in the next step limit x to 0. If we substitute y equals 0 in our function f, we get a 0 over here and a 0 over there. So we get 0 divided by something equals 0. And if you take limit y x to 0 in the next step, we don't have to do anything because we have 0, and taking x to 0 doesn't do anything, just we stay at 0. So limit along the y-axis and along the x-axis from both directions give 0. Do we now know already that the limit equals 0? No, we have taken only two ways. But we can also take another option, like for example along the line y equals kx. Then we have at once a many different paths, because we can have a k like this, a k like that, or a k like this, or a k like that. So we have many paths all at once. So we get the limit in terms of k or not. Let's see. So we substitute y equals kx in our function. Then we are over there. We see we can get rid of one factor of x, because we have x squared in the numerator and an x in the denominator. So we're left with a single factor x over there. And then in the second step, we take x to 0 of this function. And we see that we have k times x divided by some non-zero rubbish. So taking x to 0 yields 0. So now we see again we get 0. So regardless of along which line we go, we always end up at 0 with our limit. So can we now conclude that our limit equals 0? Now, still not, because we could go along a parabola or along any curve. So the problem is you cannot try any curve because there are so many options. So now, in order to really prove that your limit equals 0, you will need to use an epsilon delta argument. So what's the idea? For any epsilon bigger than 0, so someone gives you an epsilon, you cannot choose it. So for any epsilon bigger than 0, but then you may pick. You may pick a delta, such that you have to pick it in such a way that all f sets in norm are smaller than epsilon, as long as you are with your z close enough to in norm close enough to delta. So what's the idea? Here we have our epsilons. We have our 0, the number which we think will be our limit. This is a small disk around is of radius epsilon. And then we have in the domain to choose a delta. It gives us a small disk around the 0, which is this 0, set going to 0. And now we have to make sure that all points inside here are mapped inside this region over here. So you want to make sure that your delta is small enough, such that all points in this small disk in your domain are all mapped in the small disk in your codomain. How are you going to achieve this? Well, first of all, you know something about the norm of set. You know the norm of set is smaller than delta, and you can pick delta. And you want to know something about the norm of f of set. You want to get the norm of f of set below this epsilon. So the trick is to estimate the norm of the f of set in terms of the norm of set. So you have some f of set, some function in terms of set, and you have its norm, which contains some rubbish, but you only want norms of set ideally there. So how are you going to do that? Well, you remember our f of set contains the real part of x and the imaginary part of the real part of set and the imaginary part of set. And we can both estimate them in terms of the norm of set as follows. Absolute value of the real part of set is, real part of set equals x, and the absolute value of that equals the square root of x squared. And then we want to have stuff with square root of x squared plus y squared, because square root of x squared plus y squared is the norm of set. No problem, y squared is always positive, so if we add the y squared, we get that the square root of x squared plus y squared is always smaller than the square root of x squared plus y squared, which happens to be the norm of set. So in this way, you can express the absolute value of the real part of set, say in terms of the norm of set. You can show that it's always smaller than the norm of set. And something similar for the imaginary part of set equals the absolute value of y equals the square root of y squared. You can do the same trick. X squared plus y squared is bigger than y squared, so the square root of y squared is smaller equal than the square root of x squared plus y squared is again the modulus of set. And now we are ready to estimate norm of f of set. Well, that's the norm of the f of set over here, where we just plugged in what f of set was. And then we can use the property of the norm. Norm of a times b equals norm of a times norm of b. It's over there. And now we see the denominator here is already okay. There's already a norm of set. We want to have norms of set in the numerator as well. Now we can use those estimates we made over here. And then we are over there. So we see that the norm of set is smaller equal than we see that the norm of f of set is smaller equal than norm of set divided by 2. And we know that the norm of set is smaller than delta, so the norm of f of set is smaller equal than delta over 2. Now we want to pick our delta in a smart way. We want to show that this quantity over here is always smaller than epsilon. So how should we pick our delta? Someone gives us an epsilon, and then we have to pick our delta. But we can we now see how we should pick our delta. We should pick our delta such that delta over 2 equals epsilon. Because if we take this choice, so we pick delta equals 2 times epsilon. So with this choice, our norm of f of set is always smaller than epsilon if norm of set is smaller than delta. So for example, if someone gives you an epsilon of 0.1, you can pick as your delta 0.2. Or if someone gives you an epsilon of 0.001, you can pick as your delta 0.002. And then with this delta, all your function values are within this epsilon range. So you see, this is quite a difficult argument. So let's go over the crucial steps to do an exercise like this. Well, first of all, if you want to find the limit, you have to find a guess for the limit, in the sense that, so you try the easy cases first, go along the x-axis, y-axis, along the lines y equals kx, so you have an idea what the limit should be. In our case, we expected the limit to be 0. Then, a crucial step, make sure that for every epsilon, you cannot choose the epsilon yourself. You have to show for any epsilon, and then you can pick a delta. That's really important. And then the technicalities. Then you have to estimate the norm of fz minus fz zero. Your expected limit in terms of the norm of z minus z zero. So then you get something like f of z minus f z zero is smaller than something which depends on z norm of z minus z zero, which is smaller than delta. So then you have some estimate, norm of f z minus f z zero is smaller than some function of delta. And if you're there, then you're basically done, because then you have to pick your delta in a smart way. So you have some function g of delta and prescribed epsilon, and then you have to pick your delta small enough such that your function g of delta is nicely below this, in this below this epsilon. And that's the last step. So you see, if you want to do this kind of exercises, there are really some quite difficult steps, so this requires quite some practice.